morning. 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 Welcome to the Sunday morning service. This is the day that the Lord has made for us special by His resurrection. Let us rejoice in Him. Let us rejoice the gift of life that He has given to us all. Please stand. Here is a call to worship that we will respond to. This is the good news which is proclaimed to you. Walk in the light of His love. Come, let us worship the one who purifies us and makes us whole. Let us celebrate the triumph of our Lord. Amen.
You may be seated. Well, good morning. What a difference a week makes. Don't let all this sunshine pouring in through these windows fool you. It's cold outside again. We do live in Wisconsin, so we should not be surprised. But I'm pleased to spend this hour in worship with you together. We have a faithful set of ushers that are going to be bringing forward our attendance cards. I hope that you will register your attendance with us so that we can know who has been worshiping with us, but that also helps us to identify who maybe has been away for a while so we can reach out in concern. On your way in, hopefully you got our joy notes, and this is a tool that we have to keep us aware of everything that's happening within the life of this church. Let me just draw a few things to your attention. This Monday night, we are going to have an all-church meeting down in Fellowship Hall. It's an opportunity to hear, what we've been doing, where we're at, and a little vision casting for where we're headed. And the great thing about this all-church meeting is we don't have a single thing to argue about. We just are going to come together and celebrate. Is that good news?
Yes.
Well, I would hope it would have been louder than that. All right. You're invited to come and be a part of that. This Wednesday is the beginning of Lent, the holy season in the life of our church. And we don't have any Wednesday night live programming, but we still will have our community meal, 5:30 downstairs in Fellowship Hall. And then you're all invited to come here into the sanctuary for our Ash Wednesday worship service. What a wonderful way to begin this holy season. I'm aware of everything that's going on, and it's going to be an exciting service, so I hope you will be with us. Our office hours have changed. We were open from 8:30 to 4:30, and we have changed, and we are now open from 8 and 4. It was always lonely between 4 and 4:30, and when staff came in at 8:30, people were already waiting for us. So we have adjusted, so 8 to 4 is the office hours. I want to remind us of our rummage sale that's coming up. That's the yellow insert. It's going to take, I understand it's a really big deal, the rummage sale here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. And then finally, just a reminder of our Feed My Starving Children. 108,000 meals we're going to make so that we will reach the 1 millionth meal plateau in our time. And I'm not a big one for giving things up for Lent. I'm always one that encourages us to take something on, to do something new. But having said that, I'm gonna give something up this Lent. We as a staff, we do a great job of eating together. And we eat from restaurants that are out. And so during Lent, I'm going to bring my own lunch from home. And I'm going to not spend that money, and I'm going to save all the money that I would have spent on those lunches, and I'm going to use that instead to make a donation to Feed My Starving Children. We need to raise about $25,000 to prepare those 108,000 meals. And so if you want to join me in that, I encourage you to do so. And so I see that we have some children here, and I want to give them an opportunity to spend some time with a really cool guy, and that is Steve Lyerly. Steve is our new director of youth ministries. And he is going to be the person to lead us in our children's moment in Christie's absence.
Yeah,
so come on, kids, come on up.
Come on up. Coming. Calm down. Everybody got a place to sit? Great. Give everybody a chance to get here and sit down. You know, of the big people in church today are going to talk about something kind of difficult. They're going to talk about being broken. And I started thinking, how can we talk about that with you guys in children's sermon this morning? And I thought, you know, let's talk about something that's perfect. So I brought a picture of a dot. Can you see the dot? See the dot? Yeah, you people, you might want to squint if you can't see it. And those up in the balcony, don't lean over to look at it. Can you see it? Would you say that's a pretty good dot? Would you say it's perfect? It's really round? It's about as perfect as we can get it. You know, but you notice that it is all printed off to one side, right? Does anybody know why that is? You know why that is? Because I'm not really good with a copier machine, obviously. That's why it's off in one corner. Now, that maybe it's not as perfect as we think. What if we were to get really close to that circle? So I did a close-up picture of that circle. Now, how does it look? It's, pixelated. That's a nice word. Can you see it back there? Yeah. Kind of like all of us in church. Sometimes we get a little pixelated too. Sure. So sometimes we see things from afar and we think, wow, that looks perfect. Like Pastor Peace back here. Look at him. He looks rather perfect, doesn't he? And the congregation said amen. But I bet you if we got really close to him, he might tell us it's perfect about me. Well, that's kind of the way it is with God's people. And that's what they're going to talk about in church today, is that sometimes we have to be surrounded by God's love and God's people. Now, I'm going to show you another picture that's a little bit different. It's a bunch of dots. What's different about these dots? They're color, and they're funny looking. They're different shapes and sizes. See them back there? Yeah. There you go. It's kind of pretty, though, in a way, from afar. But yeah, so you got all these dots, and they're different colors and shapes and sizes. But when you put them all together, you can come up with something beautiful. And that's what God's church does. That's what they're going to talk about, and how we surround everybody with God's love in the church, and that the church is here to love us no matter what our size and shape is, whether we feel perfect or we don't feel so perfect. So sometimes we can take all those dots, put them together, and we come up with this. Now what do you see? You don't see a bunch of dots? Look real close. You see a bunch of dots? Yeah, there are a bunch of dots, but when you look far away, all those dots make a tiger. And that's how God's love works for us in the church. No matter who we are, how we feel about ourselves, what's going on in our lives, what color, size, or shape we are, what we believe and what we don't believe, we're surrounded by God's love and His church. And that makes us perfect. So I want to say a prayer. Can you guys do something for me? I want you to start the prayer for me. Can you guys do the Dear Lord part? Would you do that for me? Would you also do the Amen at the end for me? All right, and then I'll do the big long part in the middle, the hard part, okay? Can we agree to that? All right, so I'm going to count to three and you get me started. One, two, three. We thank you for your church and for your love and for surrounding us with amazing people and for the fact that we're not all alike and we're not all perfect and sometimes we are broken. And that your love brings us together and makes us feel whole again. Now, send us out into your world to share that love with other people, with our friends, our schoolmates, our family members, so that they might know how your love helps us too. In your name we pray.
Amen.
All right, you're dismissed. You can go. Thank you very much. Have a great week.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And so we turn to God in a time of silent and listening prayer. O God of compassion, we come to worship you on this day, the threshold of Lent, that season of repentance and penitence a season many find uncomfortable because it demands honesty with ourselves and with you. Some days we do find it difficult to keep up the pretense that all is well, and so we come to you today acknowledging our brokenness, our failures, our need. Like pieces of broken pottery, we wish for you to put us back together. Restore us to again be vessels of service and usefulness. We long for the wholeness which you alone can bring. Accept us as we are, O God. Forgive us and help us to remember that we are your Easter people who believe that resurrection is for us. And so we join together as forgiven and reconciled people, and we bring you the concerns and joys of our hearts. Prayers for elderly parents Dave and Marla Smilberg as they prepare for a move to a new residence in 9 days. Prayer for a future son-in-law and his choice for residency work. A plea, O God, where should I live where there is sun all year? And a celebration, a prayer of joy for baby Germana, who was born 6 weeks early. Last evening, I talked with her dad as the baby was coming into the world. The baby is doing well and healthy. All these concerns, loving God, and celebrations, and those yet unspoken, we bring to you in confidence. And in the confidence of the children of God, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples and followers. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Our ushers will come forward and receive our morning offering. And a reminder to you that the loose change offering goes to support the ministry at McCann and Brown Homeless Shelter.
Thank you. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for giving us the opportunity to worship you in this particular day. As part of your desire for honorable living, we participate in worship with a simple act of worship and act of giving. We dedicate ourselves, our offering to you, Lord Jesus. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
You may be seated. And before we hear our, we're not going to do John 16, 6 through 11, are we? Well, I don't know what that's all about. What's that about? Do you know? What's that? No? All right, never mind. So, my bulletin says we're about to sing a song called I Surrender All. And I want to introduce this song to you by telling you about my favorite performance of this hymn ever. I was a full-time youth director at a large church, and so my job was simply to work with the high school age students. And mission trips were an important part of that ministry, just as our young people here at the United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay go to Appalachia Service Project each and every year. Well, in 1989, I took a group of teenagers to Jamaica. And you say, oh, come on, what kind of a mission trip is that? Jamaica? Because we think of Jamaica just as white sandy beaches and all these resorts. But we know just a few miles inland, the majority of that country is as third world as any third world country can be. And a hurricane had just devastated that island. It came in and ripped everything up. The resorts were able to rebuild right away because they had all of the resources, all of the money, but inland it was a much different story. And so we went kind of into the jungle. We went up into the mountain areas, and we were in this little village, and our job was to rebuild an orphanage and to rebuild a church that had been knocked to the ground. The only thing that remained was the foundation of that church. No instruments, no nothing. And so we did our work, and every evening we would hold a worship service right there on the foundation of that little church that we were rebuilding. And an important part of each night's worship was testimony. People who would stand up and just share what God has been doing in their lives and thanking God for the miraculous things that they have seen. It was an incredible kind of candlelight campfire experience. And one night, this man who had just about nothing, he didn't have shoes, he was wearing ragged clothes, he came up and he was going to give his devotion. And instead of using words and telling us a story, he simply sang this song, I Surrender All. And it so touched the young people that I was there with because they were thinking to themselves, this man has nothing. What could he possibly surrender to God? They were tied up in the material things. And yet what he surrendered to God is exactly what all of us need to surrender to God, ourselves, our heart, our spirit, our longing. And so even though that was my favorite rendition of I Surrender All, I'm sure it's going to be surpassed by the way in which you all sing it to prepare our hearts for our word this day. But I'm so pleased to sing this song. Many of you know that for the last 14 years, I have been in a church that didn't sing hymns. We didn't have hymnals. We had a rock band. We sang praise songs. Every song we sang basically had a guitar solo in it, a rip and roaring guitar solo. So it's good to be here and to sing these hymns from my childhood. So let us join together in singing hymn 355, I Surrender All.
354.
Okay, and then look at the page next to it, 354. And just so we're all clear, we're not doing John 17, 6 through 11. You may be seated. We kind of went off the rails there a little bit, but I'm going to get us back right on track. We have a text that is not John 17, 6 through 11. It is 1 John chapter 1, verses 5 through 10. And it is great good news. And so if we don't have it on the screen, that's okay. It is in your bulletin, on your joy notes. Or if you simply want to look up to the altar area and simply receive it as I share this good news. And the words that we have here really is good news. This first letter to John is oftentimes called the Book of Love. And if you've never studied the first letter of John, Pastor Peace, it just very soon is going to be offering a Bible study on this book. But hear these words. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. The words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Without forgiveness or without confession, there is no forgiveness. Without acknowledging our brokenness and our woundedness, there is no healing. Do we have the capacity? Do we have the strength to allow ourselves to be vulnerable, to be human, to be truthful to our God? This is our second week in a sermon series called Searching for Sunday. And there's a group of us that are doing a book study by that name, by an author named Rachel Held Evans. And Rachel Held Evans is a millennial. And we learned last week that millennials are different than the matures generation, and baby boomers are different than the Gen X generation, and Generation Z is still clay in the potter's hands. They're still being formed and shaped as we move forward. If you want to hear what we did with the generational study, you can listen to that online by listening to the first 8 or 9 minutes of last week's sermon, a sermon that was called The Church Unites Us. Now, this is written from a millennial's point of view, and millennials are not looking for a church that is hip, that is slick, and we have been, like, unslick the last 5 or 6 minutes here. They're looking for a church that is genuine, a church that is authentic. This is the most spiritual generation that has come down the pike in some time, and yet they don't see organized religion. They don't see the Christian church doing the very things that Jesus Christ taught us to do. And so we're hearing from this generation as we work our way through this sermon series, and our sermon for today is the church tells us that we are broken, that we have a need for confession. Now, I'm not going to get up here and tell you that you're all bad people. I'm up here to tell you you're all human. And with that comes all of the frailty that every human that's ever been on earth knows, save for Jesus Christ. But the word confession, that doesn't sound very Methodist to me. Doesn't that sound Catholic to you? How many of you were raised in the Roman Catholic Church? Quite a few of us. So you all know that before you can have your first communion, you have to have your first what? Your first confession. Your first confession. And when I was growing up, my friends would go to CCD classes. That's the Catholic education. And they prepared themselves for their first confession and their first communion. And I wanted them to explain this to me. And they said, well, basically, we go and we sit in this box, and the priest is on the other side, and we tell the priest, and the priest tells us what we're supposed to pray or supposed to do in order to be made clean. And I said, but what if you've done nothing wrong? And they say, well, you just make something up. You have to have something when you're in there. And you probably don't want to tell the priest everything, because then you'd have to do too much stuff. So you give the priest just enough to satisfy everything that's going on. And that sounded foreign to me. I grew up in a church where they said to us, you know, if you have done something that you know you shouldn't do, if you have done something that is a sin, and you don't want to do it again, and you're filled with remorse that you did it, and you're going to try to do everything you can to never do it again, simply name it to God in heaven, repent, and God will forgive you of that sin, will restore you. And that seems very different than a Catholic understanding of confession. You know, I wanted to find a confessional joke to share with you. Do you know how hard it is to find a clean confessional joke to share in Sunday morning worship? You want to hear one, though?
Sure.
So there was this young woman who goes into the confessional, and she sits down and she says, "Forgive me, Father, for I have sinned, and my sin is vanity. You see, several times throughout the day, I catch a glimpse of myself in a mirror, and I just stop, and I admire myself, and I say, I am so beautiful." Well, the priest was curious, so the priest kind of looked through that little window and said, "My child, that's not a sin, it's a mistake." If that was offensive, I apologize deeply. But you see, sometimes we in the Protestant church, we as Methodists, think that whole confession thing, that's just a Catholic thing. We don't get it. And one of the things I want to share with you this day is, it is a beautiful thing. It is a part of a deep spirituality and a proper understanding of who we are and who God is. Now, I'm a big fan of our current Pope, Pope Francis. And when Peace was listening to some of the things I was working through with confession, he gave me this little book by Pope Francis called The Name of God is Mercy. And the Pope was asked the very question that I wrestle with: why should somebody go in and confess to a priest who is going to offer them forgiveness instead of directly? Why is this a necessary for we who are Roman Catholic? And the Pope responded first by stating the apostolic witness, by pointing to the Gospel of John, chapter 20, where Jesus says to these that were going to be apostles, when people confess, if you forgive them their sins, they are forgiven, but if you retain them, they are retained. So it's a tradition that goes back to the days while Jesus was still here on earth, this confession. But the Pope goes on. The Pope says, the act of going to confession to a priest is significant because humanity is a social being, and forgiveness has a social dimension. We are social beings, and forgiveness has a social implication. My sin wounds mankind, my brothers, my sisters, and society as a whole. And yet we're so self-absorbed, we just think that our sin is just between me and God. The Pope is challenging us to see that our sin wounds society as a whole. The Pope says, confessing to a priest is a way of putting my life into the hands and heart of someone else, someone who in that moment acts in the name of Jesus. It is a way to be real and authentic. We face the facts that by looking at another person and not looking in the mirror, and sometimes when we are filled with remorse and we want to repent, we just kind of look at ourselves in the mirror, and we have this incredible capacity, don't we? An incredible capacity to extend grace to ourselves, to say, it's okay, I'm not as bad as somebody else. The Pope says, if you're not capable of talking to your brother about your mistakes, you can be sure that you can't talk about them with God either. And therefore, you either end up confessing to the mirror or to yourself. Now, I'm a Methodist pastor, so I'm kind of in the priest role here within this community of faith. And as a Protestant pastor, it's amazing how many times I have been asked to really perform some of the sacraments that the Roman Catholic Church would call sacraments. How many times have I been, whether it's in somebody's living room or in a hospital room or in a hospice facility, and the family has asked me to come over and basically say a prayer for last rites for that person who's just about to pass. To say, Lord, here is your child, receive them. there is power in doing that. So too, in my office, every office I have ever had, people have come in and have confessed to me some sin that they have been wrestling with. They get this poison that they have been walking with for far too long out into the air, and it is freeing to finally name that which has been just eating away at us from the inside. Sin is a wound, and there are wounds that need fresh air to begin the healing process. So too with our sins, we need to name them. If we have sinned against a brother or a sister, Scripture is very clear. Yes, we confess to God that we have done this, but we also go and confess to that person that which we have done to them. The Pope talks about hypocrisy within all of this. He says it is hypocrisy to believe that sin is just a stain and only a stain, something that you can have dry cleaned so that it comes back normal. And maybe you've been in situations where people talk about grace and they say you write down all your sins on this board and then you just take this eraser and you just wash it clean. He said it's more than something you can just take to a dry cleaner to have removed, because it is a wound. It needs to be treated and healed. And the Pope said, every time I receive confession, I am reminded of my own need to confess. But I want to come back to this text. That text said, if we claim that we have no sin, then we're making God a liar. If we do confess our sins, we will be forgiven. Do you notice that it doesn't say if I, me, or if you? There is a we to this. There is a collection of all of us together. We as a humanity, we as Christians, we as Americans have collectively all committed some sins that we need to repent of. Think about the way in which we have sinned as humanity against the earth and the environment. Are we repentant about that? Think about the way in which we as humanity have this thirst for power and for control. Do we repent about that? Think about the way in which this country, we as Americans, for so long said that slavery is just, it is right, it is God ordained. I read this week that prior to the Civil War, 50% of the defenses that were being published for pro-slavery were written by clergy speaking on behalf of their congregations. Do we repent? Think about the way in which, in the name of evangelism, in the name of bringing good news to people, we have tried to civilize people in order to Christianize people, to say, no, if you're going to be Christian, you need to throw your culture out and take ours. I heard a story of a tribal leader from Hispaniola, and these missionaries were there trying to convert him, and they said, basically, either convert or die. Convert or die? They said, yes, either right now you choose to accept Christ and go to heaven, or we're going to kill you and you go to hell. And he said, well, let me get this straight. If I confess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I get to go to heaven where all you are going to be? Kill me now! I choose hell. Do we repent for that? Do we repent for the way in which our bellies are full and we hoard food while the rest of the world and even the rest of people, or there are people in pockets of our own country that are starving? We collectively need to confess our sins. Now, some of you may be sitting here saying, Pastor Matt, you're not making me feel good. I come to church to feel good. But we need to know that church is not a museum for saints. What is church? It is a hospital for sinners. And if you are a sinner, that means you have to acknowledge your sin. Admit, here I am, United Methodist Church of Whitefish Bay. I am flawed, and I did some things this week I shouldn't. I had some thoughts this week I shouldn't. But here I am because I have this need for God. I have this need for community. Do we have the power to be authentic? Do we have the power to be real enough that we can let go of our masks and not pretend to hide our pain? Evans, in this book that we've been studying, says something that's kind of surprising. She says, you know what the most holy hour in any church's week is? The most sacred hour spent in any church building? It's not on Sunday mornings in the sanctuary. the holiest hour in the church is more likely to be found on a Tuesday night or a Thursday noon in a fellowship hall or a church parlor where a bunch of people are together with stale pastries and weak coffee. And they gather together, and they are a group of CEOs and stay-at-home moms, homeless veterans and suburbanites, and they come together and they acknowledge that they are powerless and that they have dependency. They confess themselves to one another and to God about the nature of their wrongs. They ask for help. They summon the courage to expose their darkness to light. Their call to worship sounds something like, "Hi, my name is John, and I'm an addict. Hi, my name is Katie, and I too am an addict. I'm an alcoholic. Hi, my name is Steve, and I have a gambling problem that has cost me everything." Open and honest. Confession. Where there's confession, there is forgiveness and healing. Forgiveness and healing. Our text today said, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. In all of these church basements, here are people who no longer are deceiving themselves. They have chosen to speak the truth. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, the one who is alone with their sin is utterly alone. And so we need confession. And so let me quickly just lay out for you four things that I see that confession does for the person who is engaged in the practice. The first thing is, confession teaches us how to be vulnerable, how to be authentic, how to be genuine. I am a Christian, says Evans, because Christianity names and addresses sin. It acknowledges the reality that the evil we observe in the world is also present within ourselves. It tells the truth about the human condition, that we're not always okay. And so we see, friends, that the practice of confession gives us a chance to admit to one another that we might not be okay, but that we can seek reconciliation together. The second thing confession does is it reveals things as they really are. It sheds the light of truth. You see, we all move through the world in the same state, broken and beloved. That we all are in need of healing. And this gives us power. It emboldens us to confess to one another not only our sins, but to confess our fears, our doubts, our questions, our injuries, our pain. It gives us permission to start telling one another the truth, and that to believe that this strange way of living together in community is what can set us free. Brandon Manning writes, "When I get honest, I admit that I am a bundle of paradoxes. I believe and I doubt, and I get discouraged. I love and I hate. I feel bad about feeling good. I feel guilty about not feeling guilty. I am trusting and suspicious. I am honest, and yet I still play games. Aristotle says I am a rational animal. I say I am an angel with an incredible capacity for beer." Confession helps to see things the way they really are. But we transition into some good news. Confession reveals that we are not alone, that God is with us. Paul writes to Timothy, "Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst, but not the only, I would add." Jesus came not just for the righteous, certainly not for those that thought they had religion all figured out, God all figured out, but Jesus came for the sinners. Jesus came for those that knew they were sick and were reaching out for healing. Jesus spent his time with those that were downcast, that were left over, that were thrown out. Jesus came and brought healing and grace to those who acknowledged that they were broken and wounded. Us. The final thing confession does for us is it leads to cleansing. When we confess and we receive that forgiveness, we are right with God. But friends, without a truly repentant spirit, a simple cry for mercy and for grace is a cry for permission to keep on doing what we've always been doing. It'll never change. No, we need a change. We need to repent. We need to turn around and walk the other way. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's not just New Testament. Even in the Old Testament, God's people were told this. The psalmist writes in Psalm 32, verse 5, "Then I acknowledged my sin to you, and I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin." Proverbial wisdom, Proverbs 28:13. "No one who conceals transgressions will prosper, but one who confesses and forsakes them will obtain mercy." And so, friends, I want to challenge you. I want you to be brave enough to be open and honest, not only with God, but with one another. We're about to enter into the most holy of seasons, the season of Lent. We're going to work our way all the way from this Wednesday up to the Sunday where we come in and we're all waving palm branches and there's a donkey in here. We're going to have the greatest celebration of the year on Easter Sunday with our beautiful Easter lilies and all the wonderful music. And we're going to proclaim that He is risen. He is risen indeed. But friends, we need to go through a journey before we get there. Evans says this in her book, and I want to leave us with this day. Once a year, on a Wednesday, we mix ashes with oil. We light candles and confess to one another and to God that we have sinned by what we have done and what we have left undone. We tell the truth. Then we smear the ashes on our foreheads and together acknowledge the single reality upon which every Catholic and Protestant, believer and atheist, scientist and mystic can agree. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you will return. It's the only thing we know for sure. We will die. And so, brothers and sisters, may God give you the courage to be people who take your confession, your brokenness, your wounds seriously, and let us take them to the ultimate source of forgiveness. Yes, brokenness can be a dark place, but there is light. Light in Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand and join together in singing hymn 133, "Leaning on the Everlasting Arms."
Thank you.
so, brothers and sisters, as we depart from this house of worship, let's depart to make every moment we encounter out there a sacred moment where God is with us. Let us have the courage to be honest with one another and honest with ourselves, because that is the road to true healing and forgiveness. Go in peace. Amen.